a lot of the players have never been here before. So the manager wanted us out there having a good look around and sampling up the atmosphere. And like I said, the lads enjoyed it this afternoon.
Bet you wish you were 25 years younger, don't you, Mick?
Cool, I do. It's a smashing stadium. It's great, you know. I can't believe England can't afford to have a stadium like this, can you? It breaks your heart. But just a great feel when you get here, and the excitement and the cars coming down across that bridge. There's so many Southampton fans on the way here already. It's unbelievable.
Similar to 76, similar feelings?
Absolutely.
To you?
I mean, I think the atmosphere in, you know, not that I've been in Southampton that much, but I was earlier this week, and it was great atmosphere everywhere. Everybody's looking forward to it. But it was exactly the same. And, you know, if we can pull it off tomorrow, which I think we've got a great chance, you know, Sunday would be an unbelievable day, that's for sure. Because I remember 76, and it was brilliant then.
We'll see some of the shots of the bus parade from 76 later. Are the players offended by their tag as underdogs?
No, not really. We're playing Arsenal. We know what a great side Arsenal are. So, in theory, we are definitely the underdogs. Everyone's speaking about Arsenal had a chance of the treble this year and they're just going to be getting the FA Cup. So that's something that spurns us on. We know that it's going to be difficult, but we proved this year we had a good result against them at our place. So we proved that we can beat them. We just go out there and perform tomorrow.
OK, Jason, Mick, thank you very much. We'll have more from Jason and Mick in a moment. First, though, let's remind ourselves of how Saints got here. Our guides are the supporters who've given us their favourite moments on the road to Cardiff.
Favourite FA Cup moment is probably right at the start, third round, Anna Svensson. That goal was just absolutely awesome. And it was Glenn Hoddle, so it was just unbelievable.
I really liked the third round when we beat Glenn Hoddle.
Derby Spurs, 4-0 with Spurs, was superb. Best game you've seen.
Beattie, straight at Keller, and spilled in! It's in, second attempt, Southampton lead! Chance for Tesson to get a second, he has! Anders Svensson going all the way, Anders Svensson still going, and he scored! 3-0! Now he needs a cross into the penalty area, he's got it, beats his header, brilliant, second play, it's in this time, it's 4-0.
If it wasn't for Kevin Davis, we wouldn't be here anyway, so if you're scoring at the last minute in the Millwall game.
My best bit was when Ken Davis got this goal.
Matty Oakley's second goal at Millwall to get us through to the next round. I thought that was just brilliant, I thought it was excellent. And start from then on, we were going to win it.
And Claridge is in, and Claridge has scored for Millwall. Anders Svensson back to Tesson, nips past him, left foot, saved by Warner, Davis, goal Southampton! The edge of the box, played back to Oakley, who drills it in. Wonderful strike. Right side of the box, here's the cross, Reed's there, off of Naimi, and it's in! And it's Oakley shooting for the edge of the area, and Oakley shooting in for his second goal!
We played Norwich in the FA Cup, Norwich were on the attack, they hit the post, and Saints went down the other end, scored, it's a terrific feeling.
Here comes McVeigh, gets onto his right foot, and curls it off the post! And here comes Anders Svensson to push Southampton into the lead! Morrison, left side of the box, shoots, saved, Tesson, goal!
My favourite bit from the cup run was when Chris Marsden scored from the overhead kick, because me and Georgina were on TV on that night, because we could see ourselves behind the goal, and I was just going...
Chris Marsden, overhead kick, because I don't think he could ever do that again.
In it comes again, and at the near post once more, Saints, and they're hooking it back, and they're hooking it in! It's gone in, and it's the former Wolves man, Chris Marsden! Right, here's the cross, Beattie's there, and it's in!
My favourite bit was Brett Ormwood's goal. It was absolutely fabulous. The atmosphere is fabulous, everything about it was, it's great.
The most magic moment of all has to be Villa. Arriving at the ground, all the fans there, everything, the whole atmosphere was electric.
inside the box. Marsden chip, and the header from O'Rourke, it's in! Hit the cross, and it's in! And Southampton now are facing their first FA Cup final in 27 years.
Happy memories, eh? It's in! Tony Husband, the commentator, what more do you need to know? Jason, it's been an easy cup run though, hasn't it? You've had first division teams the whole way along.
I wouldn't really call it easy. The Spurs game was probably the biggest game.
They were the exception, weren't they? They were the only exception.
And that was probably our best performance of the season. I mean, 4-0 didn't really tell the whole story. We could have won it a lot more comfortable. And that, I think, set the supporters up for the run that we got. But the first division side we played, they were all good sides. They were all in good form. So I wouldn't really say we've had an easy run. OK, we've had first division sides, but they've all been playing decent football when we've had to play against them.
Mick, we're all looking for omens. We're all looking for comparisons to 76 to clutch onto.
Yeah, what happened to us was when Huey Fisher scored in the first game against Aston Villa for us. Huey never scored goals. End of story, you know. I mean, he fired one in the last minute, and same with the Millwall game when Kevin Davis come on. And there's so many sort of things that are very similar to our cup run, you know. But we were a second division side, if you remember, in them days. And we were a bigger outsider than you are tomorrow. They're 5-1. We were 7-1 on the day. A lot of people won a lot of money that day, that's for sure.
During the course of the week, we've been asking for texts and emails. We'll read some of them out during the evening. Martin in Romsey says that he really thinks that we can win the Cup this year and we can go on to even bigger and better things like the UEFA Cup. Win or lose, he says, though, he'll have a fantastic day. And that's the thing. It's about the fans tomorrow, isn't it?
Of course, yeah. I mean, we're going to be bringing nearly 30,000 fans down. And as Mick was saying, they've been travelling down today. Lots of people are staying for the whole weekend. And then hopefully on the Sunday when we go back, we're going to travel back about 10, up as 10 in the morning. We're hopefully going to bring the trophy home with us. And then we're going to have a good trip in the afternoon around the town.
Fantastic. We'll talk a bit about the bus tour, all being well, in a little moment. Gordon Strachan, of course, is the man who has masterminded Southampton's run to the final. But how has he done it? Well, we asked the former Saints boss, Dave Merrington, to find out more about the man who, it transpires, is not always the volatile character that you see on the television.
Just imagine, let's just imagine we've won the cup. You've won the cup. What will it mean to you, the club, and actually joining the managers who've won the cup?
But first of all, I think there's been some dodgy managers that won the cup, let's get that right. Because really, all you have to do is be lucky for five games. You know, in the league, that's what I keep saying, the league...
But it's special, the final's special, isn't it?
I've just killed one or two managers, isn't it? I think your great managers are deciding who wins the league championship, how many times they win the league. I don't think great managers are counted on who won the FA Cup. Fantastic experience and you've done well for that season, but it doesn't make you a great manager. What it does is make people very, very happy and adds to the history of the club.
I mean, you've done a great job here, Gordon, and give us an insight into how you think you've turned things around here.
Well, first of all, I made my mind up because when I was at Coventry, you get caught up in all sorts of things and tactics and this and that and politics, and you forget that the basis of being a football player, first, you have to pass the ball, and secondly, to use that skill, you have to be fit. So I decided when I got the next job, the team's got to be fit. I don't care what they've got to do, mumble, grumble, moan, do what they want, but you've got to be fit. And people think, first players, when you start running, oh, we're not an athletics club, are we? No, that's rubbish. Mm. It's not that. It's to make you fitter so you can use your skill longer. Whether it be Fabrice Fernandez, you can keep beating people. You know, if you're Anders Svensson, you can keep Matthew Oakley can keep taking the ball under pressure because he's now fitter. Mm. James Beattie can keep making runs. And then when he's in the box, because if he's fitter, he can compose himself.
You've got the reputation along the way of being a bit of a fiery character. Give us a little bit of an insight. You close the door, you've gone into the dressing room. What makes Gordon Strachan tick? We're getting inside of you now.
Well, they'd be surprised. I think most people would be surprised at half time that I don't say anything for 5 minutes, have a cup of tea. You know, and people think I shut the door and storm about and shout and scream. I don't say a thing for 5 minutes. I know what I'm going to say. I collect my staff and go, lads, have you spotted anything? Dennis, Gary, what do you think? Bump the players, I want them to get changed again in new gear, they have a cup of tea and sit down and talk. So there's never anything fire at half time.
Yeah. Do you find football controls your life? How do you get the balance between football and your family life?
It's never been a problem to me. even when I was a footballer. Obviously, my demands where I played there, played in Europe, played in the World Cup, you have to go and do that. But you've got to spend a lot of time with your family. I've always been a family that's went and done everything together. Theatre, cinema, holidays, we're always good holidays. So I've always had time for them, and it's not a problem. And as a manager, I've learnt to say, right, okay, this is me and Les, I do this on Wednesday, we do this on Thursday. So we've always got plenty of time.
Yeah.
They're all going to be at the game, and that's why, as I said to you early on, it's such a special occasion. Because I think Alec Ferguson's wife and kids have been to so many cup finals, and Arsene Wenger's wife and whatever he's got have been to so many cup finals. We don't get to too many as a family. So that's a special thing for me. That's another thing. I've always took families together, and we've always done everything together. It's got to be another memory for us as a group.
Last summer, I remember Bridgie coming back from the internationals and everything. There was a lot of talk about trying to keep them as a club, and now all of a sudden in the paper you've got Beattie in the paper, and we're going into the close season. The club, these players now, I mean, you want to try and keep them, or is it going to be difficult? Is football now?
It's not changed in any way. You had it years ago, you had Shearer here, you had Tiz here, you had people like that, Williams. You know, and other clubs are interested in them. The only thing that makes players move on is themselves. But one thing you've got here is a good standard of living, good club, and you've got a magnificent stadium now. It's a good environment to work. But I think Southampton full stop is a good environment to work.
A lot of speculation about Gordon Strachan during the course of the season. He was coveted by other people, but listening to that, he's not going anywhere, is he?
Well, why does he need to go? Right. I mean, we're in Europe, we've got a great bunch of players, a good squad, and the manager hopefully will have some money to spend to bring some more players in. So he's enjoying himself, and he's enjoying working with a bunch of lads that he got there. So we certainly believe that he's definitely going to be at the start next year.
Interesting there in that interview, Mick, to hear him say that he doesn't actually say anything for 5 minutes at half time when he goes into the dressing room.
What,
unusual,
kick boots
that.
About or what?
He just sips his tea, doesn't he? I mean, that seemed almost out of odds, you know, out of sync with the character that we see.
Yeah, I mean, football, I was talking to Jason earlier, and the game's changed so much, you know, and, you know, different approaches, you know, they have all sorts of psychologists and people, and I think that the managers are a lot deeper thinking now. You know, when you think of Arsene Wenger, he's brought in all these dietitians, and now I believe you brought him in at Southampton. Mm-hmm. So the game has changed. Can you imagine Peter Osgood and Jimmy McCalliog and the lads in 76 listening to a psychologist? It wouldn't have happened.
No. Interestingly, just looking at the emails again, Peter Turner and Chandler's forward, Arsenal may have beaten Saints 6-1 the other week, but Saints weren't playing their best team. Andrew Dean from Romsey says the Gunners have had no problem scoring goals, but Saints will probably have to score twice because of that. However, Arsenal may be a weak in defence. Are those things that you've pinpointed, Jason, in your preparations?
To be fair, this year our defensive record have been very good, apart from the 6-1. As you said, the manager tried a few different ideas, as simple as that, trying not to give too much away for the final. But apart from that, the defensive record has been very, very good. And as we've seen with James, I mean, James expects to score. Every time he goes out, he expects to score. And with Brett, I mean, Brett hasn't got the praise that he deserves either. He works very, very hard. And because being a striker, the goals haven't been going in for him, people don't see the actual good work that he's putting in. And that work he's putting in is probably doing James a favour and freeing him up. And James has not been missing, so...
Yeah. But don't you think, I mean, this stadium, this game, you can throw the form book out the window. Because it's certainly on the day, you know. I mean, and it's how the lads perform. And, I mean, they'll be wound up for sure. You know, we were, and I, they're focused on winning, and that's what it's all about.
We'll talk about BT and Ormerod later, but the point you raise is an interesting one. Saints are the underdogs. Most of the country, indeed, will be expecting to see them thrashed here tomorrow. And as Mick alluded to, it was the same before the 76 Cup final. The team that won for Southampton that year by beating Manchester United is still revered, of course, by the fans. And we brought three members of the class of 76 together, a striker, Peter Osgood, a defender, Mel Blythe, and a midfielder, Nick Holmes, to reminisce about a performance and a result which we all hope can be repeated tomorrow.
BBC cameras are down there in the part of the hotel or whatever, and we're all there, and they're going through talking to people, and I just remember thinking, oh my God, what am I going to say? And you Good as Gold has always came to my rescue and said a few words for
good
me.
Good as Gold?
Put my arm on his back. On
I mean, when you left the hotel, that people were saying this, that, and the other, and we were, I think, what was it, 7-1, 8-1 against?
6-1.
6-1 against? Yeah. And I just thought, nah.
No.
And soon, and as I say, on the day, all right, we had our luck, but I thought we were, yeah, the team to win it.
Yeah, we rode our luck for
first quarter, the first, 20
yeah,
minutes.
20 minutes, didn't yeah. we? Yeah. But I mean, I've seen the video since then. I can't remember it from the time, but we did. We actually grew in confidence, didn't we, all the time? By the time
I thought the back five won it for us. Yeah. As you say, we rode our luck in the first 20, 25 minutes, and then, as you say, they give us confidence, give you confidence. We could see it. Shannon started to play as usual.
You just felt then, didn't you? It was a question of time or
and
whatever.
Whether we were going to be able to score, crack it, and we did.
Yeah.
We had the luck.
Oh, I mean, yeah, that was a good ball, great ball, wasn't it? Oh. Great ball through as well.
Three balls, Jimmy Dunn, and that was
the killer one, wasn't it?
McGarrigle to Stokes, who's onside. 1-0. And Southampton take the cup for the first time in their history. One of the great Wembley upsets. The team now going towards the Southampton end.
The next day was great because all of a sudden everybody was together, the players, the wives, the friends, the family and everything.
I could not believe getting on that bus, the amount of people that they could generate.
Everywhere you went, there were people. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. I mean, obviously Chelsea was fantastic, but...
Well, the town had never saw anything that size before. I mean, you know, ever.
Well, Mick, we saw you there with the cup in your hand, racing down the touchline, singing on the balcony. You must have very fond memories.
It was brilliant, brilliant memories. And Ozzie on there. I mean, I always remember the night he took the FA Cup home. That FA Cup you showed is not the real one. Ozzie's still got the proper FA Cup in his name, so I promise you.
That's what he says.
But, no, I always remember Ozzie and the lads. Some great characters and a great day for Southampton, but... As I said, Ozzie took the FA Cup home, slept with the FA Cup. No one else has ever done that.
And I dare say no one will get the chance to do it tomorrow, whichever
team wins.
So many
security guards chasing them around.
There are loads of couple of burly guys with it, aren't there? All Southampton fans, of course, will be hoping that the Cup goes home with the Saints tomorrow and 2003 joins 1976 on the Roll of Honour tomorrow. They'll be descending on Cardiff in their thousands, but some are already here. Tony Husband is about 5 minutes' walk from the stadium with a rare group. For them, the Cup final... it's a home game. Tone.
Yes, thanks, Roger. We're at the Moloko Vodka Bar, where we are with the Cardiff Saints. These are the Saints fans that are based here in Cardiff, and they will be in the Millennium Stadium tomorrow. Rich Harper, you are the secretary. You must be very proud to have your team actually at home for once.
It's awesome for us. You know, it's a fantastic occasion. We spend a lot of time driving up and down to Southampton to see the Saints. For them to come to us for a change, it's fantastic.
How long have you been following them?
Oh, since I was a small boy, probably about 30 years now, maybe a bit more. That gives away my age then.
Tremendous, and you're looking forward to tomorrow without a doubt. It should be a massive day.
It's a massive day, of course it is. You know, 27 years since the last cup final that Saints appeared in. We didn't think it was going to happen this season quite so quickly. You know, Gordon Strachan's done a fantastic job. Luck's been with us. We trounced Spurs on the way. And now, tomorrow, you know, it's the Arsenal's turn.
Thanks very much, Rich. I hope you have a good day tomorrow. Let's actually go across the bar here, talk to a few more punters who are in. Not too much vodka this evening. But what are you looking forward to tomorrow?
It's going to be a great day. I've been looking forward to it for a long time. Going with friends Nigel and Helen, and it's going to be fantastic.
Now, you've not come from Cardiff, have you? Come from further away?
That's correct, yeah. I'm from Guernsey in the Channel Islands. Yeah, I flew over this morning at 6:45 and I've come over for tomorrow, but I haven't got a ticket, but I'm hoping one of my Cardiff Saints friends will help me out.
Good stuff. Well, Poto too, but there's scarce supply, I would say. Yeah. Should be a good day. What's it going to be like in that stadium?
It's going to be a fantastic atmosphere. If the lid's shut, noise will be bouncing everywhere, and I think everyone's going to have a fantastic day, and at the end of the day, we'll be celebrating as we win the Cup.
You think that right result tomorrow?
Absolutely, Saints to win.
Okay, well, we'll hope that's the result tomorrow. There's one big Southampton fan, though, who won't be here tomorrow. He'll actually be on the other side of the pond. It's Southampton's own Craig David. And I went up to London earlier this week to catch up with him. Yeah.
but you don't realize what this means to me. So let me have just one more chance. I'm not the man I used to be.
To be in the final, especially against Arsenal, which is such a big London team, it's great to see the underdogs in there with a good chance, because James Beattie's played amazing this season. So I think we could do it.
So where are you going to be?
I'm sort of hard done by, because I'm actually going to be out in LA, because we're doing a performance with Sting at a radio station. So I'm going to have to find myself in some kind of local pub. I think it's going to be about 7 o'clock in the morning with the time difference and everything. And sit there trying to keep my eyes open, which hopefully the jet lag will help me, and spur on Southampton all the way, a million miles away. But I think I'll be the only Southampton supporter there, because all the Americans, they'll be like, oh, Arsenal, just because Arsenal happens to be a London team and we know Thierry Henry. But I'm going to be there supporting my team.
I always said that I was going to make it. Now it's plain for everyone to see.
It's just really weird to meet these players now and them sort of saying, oh, came out to see you at the Royal Albert Hall. It was wonderful seeing you perform. And I'm thinking, I was a little kid who was trying to lean over the barrier to get your autograph about 4 years ago, or last week. But, so it's all good.
But some things you may find can take over your life.
Look at this!
Now then, this is from us. We thought if you're going to find a bar in LA on Saturday
that
morning,
fantastic.
Maybe you'd want to put the yellow shirt they're going to wear on, and you've even got your own name on it.
That is so cool.
That's from Southampton Football Club and from BBC South. And
that is very cool. Thank you very much.
No problem.
Very kind of you. I will wear this ablaze in the pub, especially with Craig David and number 9 on the back. You can't go wrong. Superstar, you're fine, baby.
David will have a very keen eye then on events here tomorrow. We've heard from the celebrities, the manager and the old boys, but what about the players themselves? They've admitted that they will all have to be on top form to beat Arsenal, and of course they'll have to score to win. So the strikers, James Beattie and Brett Ormerod, are key. They both grew up in Lancashire, where their partnership was first formed.
I knew James because we was apprentices at Blackburn together. So, I used to get him. He used to put my ankle strappings on at the time because I was too scared to go and ask a physio to do it when I was a kid at Blackburn. So, he helped me out and things like that and stuff. So I knew him very well at Blackburn and that. And he's a great lad. Then he hasn't changed. He's still loud and he's still mad. You know, and if anything, he's got worse.
He's had a rocky path, as it were. You know, to get back to the top. But he was always very good, you know, when we was at Blackburn. And I think they said, you know, he was too slight at Blackburn. But obviously, as you grow up, you fill out. And, you know, he's a strong lad now. And, you know, he's had to be mentally strong as well.
Beats has been on fire this season. He was, to be fair, last season until he got an injury. And, I think he's just proved this year what a quality striker he is. He's got confidence in abundance. He's in that zone where everything he hits just goes in. And, fair play to him. He works very hard for the team and that, and he deserves all he gets.
He's been magnificent all season. His work rate for the side, the space he creates for myself and other people is quite tremendous. And it was just deserves what he got in the semi-final, and I was so pleased for him when he scored.
Beats and Brett, real characters those pair. Jason, how important are they?
They're very important to us. It might work in our favour tomorrow. Everyone knows what Beats can do. So Arsenal might have... I mean, they might be too focused on James and all that sort of thing, and it might be the day for Brett. It was that case in the semi-final. I think Watford were too focused on James, and Brett came good. So I'll be pleased for him, because he works very hard, and as I said earlier, he doesn't get the credit that he deserves. So it would be great if he managed to not win in tomorrow.
Are they a better partnership than, say, Shannon and Osgood?
They're fitter, that's for sure.
They're a lot now.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, and then, probably. But now they've had a great season, and, they complement each other. Brett does all the, is the workhorse. And I just feel if they can load the gun, James will fire it. And, If they can do that, I think they've got a great chance.
There's so much expectation on James Beattie. I remember 74, Malcolm McDonald, I think, went into the final with Newcastle, built up as this great striker and froze a bit.
Yeah, but he's the star, so they're going to build him up.
Is there a danger that one of them might freeze?
This, probably the same in ours. They built me up and Stokesy scores the winner. I mean, it doesn't matter who scores the winner in the cup final. And, you know, I mean, I hope someone from midfield or a defender does, but I just feel that... If they can keep loading it up for him, I mean, they are a bit vulnerable at the back, and Beats is good in the air. He's got two great feet. I mean, if they get lucky, I mean, I think they could win comfortable, you know.
It'd be great if they could. Mm-hmm. How important is the team spirit that Saints have had this season, Jason?
Very important. I mean, over the years, that's probably when we've had the relegation battles. That's what's pulled us through. But this year, nowadays as well, it is squads. Before the big clubs, they've talked about squads and they've got 18, 20 players, and that's not been our strongest point. But now the manager's brought 21 players with this, even myself and Roy that have been injured, because it has been a squad situation. He wanted to bring us all together because the unit is very strong. So I think it's helped us big time. And like I said, whoever's out there playing tomorrow, the other lads that aren't involved will be giving everyone their backing.
Fantastic. Plenty of inspiration from what we've heard here this evening. We are, of course, now less than 20 hours from kickoff. And for big national events, everyone turns to the BBC. The FA Cup final, of course, is no exception. Unrivaled coverage from Match of the Day starts here on BBC One at 12:10 tomorrow afternoon. They'll have all the build-up, uninterrupted match coverage and post-match analysis. Coverage on the radio has already started. BBC Radio Solent is live from here in Cardiff from 9 o'clock in the morning. Sports Time has the whole match live with Alan Ball, Dave Merrington and Tony Husband from 12:05. It's crystal ball time. 5 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. Who lifts the cup, Saints or Arsenal?
Read my lips.
Go on.
3-1 to Southampton.
Jason?
Maybe not 3-1, but I'll take 2-1. I fancy James scoring. And like I said, I fancy the defence is very strong. We're a good unit. So, yeah, I fancy 2-1.
It's unanimous in the studio. Saints to win the cup.
I think we're biased.
Jason and Mick, thank you both very much indeed. We finish with a text message from Mrs. Cook. My daughter Julie is getting married to Richard Rossdale on Saturday at 2 o'clock. She is begging the male guests to turn up, especially Richard, no doubt. Enjoy the wedding. Enjoy the cup final. Let's hope it's all Saints Day. From all of us in Cardiff, a very good night to you.
Time and time again. Ever thought you?
Good afternoon and welcome to Cardiff for the 122nd FA Cup final. It's the third time that the teams will come out of the tunnel here at the Millennium Stadium, and once again, Arsenal will be one of them. As for Arsenal's opponents today, Southampton, well, this place wasn't even a green shoot in the valleys when they last won the cup. Oh, and speaking of green things...
Our very special guest is the year 1976!
And a tremendous roar as Laurie McMenemy on the right leads out Southampton. Manchester United to start this FA Cup final.
33 degrees centigrade, which is 91 Fahrenheit.
Is that why you're keeping a tie on? It's going to get cold.
I put the tie on because it's BBC television.
Now McAllister for Shannon, a brilliant ball.
The world
is about to become a smaller place. Soon you'll be able to travel a mile every 3 seconds.
Osgood! John Curry has won the Olympic gold medal for figure skating.
That is Olympic history for Nadia Comaneci.
You do feel a certain relief at the burden falling off your shoulder, as I say, a seven-day-a-week burden.
Lolly McBenamy and Southampton take the cup for the first time in their history.
They're what are we saying, sir?
Wonderful people.
Are they?
Oh, yes, they really turn us on.
Well, the ball won't start rolling down there until 3 o'clock, but we've got plenty to keep you entertained in the meantime. We'll hear from Arsene Wenger and talk to those who know him best. Yes, that's his dad. Alan Hansen has been to the South Coast for a tête-à-tête with Gordon Strachan.
What do you think you'll be like at 3 o'clock Saturday?
I'm looking very smart. I've got a lovely suit.
Nice suit, yeah.
Lovely suit.
Again, emotionally.
You're trying to get this emotional thing.
I'm trying to get into your head.
You know what I'm like?
It's very difficult to get into your head.
Please do not try and do it, because it's not very funny in there.
David Seaman will captain Arsenal this afternoon. He and Ray Parlour are playing their 5th FA Cup final. We'll speak to both of them. Southampton striking duo James Beattie and Brett Ormerod are playing their first. We'll hear from them. We'll be marking the 50th anniversary of the Matthews final. And Bobby Robson joins us live 25 years after Ipswich won the cup. And as we look back on this year's competition, we find that Motti's lost the plot. Or is it the cup?
Someone's stolen the FA Cup, apparently, and if they don't get it back, there's talk of them cancelling the final.
Sounds serious. How can I help?
And as usual at the Cup final, it's a case of, I'm a celebrity, get me a ticket. Now, a lot's been made of the importance of drawing the lucky North dressing room. Liverpool had it 2 years ago, Arsenal were in there last season, and this year, well, the coin fell in favour of Southampton. But I suppose if you're a saint, you're entitled to a little bit of luck, and they might just need it. Ivan Gaskell has been with the Outsiders.
It's been a long and gruelling campaign, but while most footballers are putting their feet up this week, Southampton are still putting the work in. They still have their eyes on a glittering prize. Cup final week, cup final trappings, sunshine and sweat, media attention and a good tailor.
Chris, what do you think of the suit?
Very nice.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Your sort of style? Sort of thing you normally wear?
Nice fabric, yeah.
Good for your wardrobe too. Quite nice.
Yeah.
I've got no style, it's where I'm given.
Biggest cup competition in the world, isn't it?
Good for the city, good for the club, good for me as Amsterdam fan.
It's a different story on Saturday, you know, when the whistle blows.
I've been training hard and started on team shape already.
It's a formation Chris Marsden aims to be part of.
Are you going to be fit for the big one?
I hope so. I mean, it's not very often FA Cup finals come around, so hopefully I'll be training Thursday. I mean, I've been struggling the last few days, I think everybody knows that, but I'm hopeful, yeah.
Midweek, injury concerns receding. Southampton clearly a happy camp. Manager Gordon Strachan being, well, Gordon Strachan.
You like that for a minute there, weren't you? I wonder where this is going.
I'm only joking.
This is cup final week. You enjoying all this?
I'm enjoying this week. The league's out of the way, which was a problem. To try and fight on two fronts for us is a problem. There's no doubt about that. So we are enjoying it, yeah. But we're working very hard. And we're ready. We're ready.
After 27 years of waiting for another FA Cup final, so is the city of Southampton. And if you're still looking for a seat for the big match...
We make these chairs. This is signed by the man himself.
And this is a traditional chair, more for the executive.
And what's this in the window?
This is a chair in tribute to dear old Bobby Stokes.
Cup final fever's clearly gone to their heads. Everyone's getting behind the team.
Come on, you Saints.
Come on, Southampton!
I think we can wipe the floor with Arsenal. We'll make Southampton proud. At the same time, we've got the talent and the tactical play to do it. So just enjoy yourself. You've got this far, the FA Cup final, kill it.
Come on, you Saints!
There's more than one way to Cardiff. As for the Southampton squad, more conventional means. Goalkeeper Niemi apparently fit again and raring to go. Gordon Strachan has Chris Marsden back in training too. 25,000 will follow the Saints west. Last one out of Southampton, please turn the lights out. Destination Cardiff Bay, the only desire now, a decent night's sleep.
So, Saturday lunchtime and the clock ticking towards kick-off. I'm told that Southampton will be led by their captain, Chris Marsden, today. He's recovered from that knee injury. He'll play without the aid of an injection. Southampton may be outsiders, but Gordon Strachan has a game plan specifically for this final. Expect a surprise or two when the lineup's named a little later on.
So, the Arsenal players will be hanging their cup final suits in the same dressing room they were in when they lost to Liverpool 2 years ago. But footballers have never been a superstitious lot. Much. Our man with the Gunners, Damian Johnson.
It's finished at Highbury. Arsenal 2, Leeds 3. And what chance now that this Arsenal team will end up this season with nothing?
I cried all the way home.
FA Cup final, second in the table. Could be a lot worse, couldn't it?
A joyful day out, a nice diversion, and a good little end of the season. Second best to the real thing, the double, but it's better than nothing.
It is not a consolation, it is a prize. And we don't want to be consolated, we are frustrated because we didn't win the league.
I think a lot of players are disappointed with the season. We set ourselves a target to win all three trophies, and we haven't won any yet.
With so many preoccupations, it was Wednesday before the team picked up their suits. For the record, a grey designer number. If the players get their way and a departure from tradition, they may turn up without a tie for this, their third final in a row.
I'm glad Freddie didn't pick this suit. Can you imagine? Yeah. Can you imagine if Freddie... Oh, blimey. There would be holes in it and everything.
Gosh, would a lot of white socks.
Yeah, I know. Michael Jackson.
Thursday was open day at the training ground, a chance to watch the players going through their paces. And then some of the key men faced the media. The main talking point was Arsenal's lineup for Saturday.
I don't know who's going to play in the centre-back alongside with Martin.
You know, nobody knows about it. I'm not sure as well.
You have so many good players in the dressing room who can be better than me on Saturday.
Are you playing?
Yeah, I'm going to play.
Some knew they were playing, others were unclear, so the manager put everyone in the picture.
Lauren looks like he has recovered, Luzny has recovered, Reparla has recovered. Audis, Pascal Sigan, Patrick Vieira, Saul Campbell, of course, and everybody else. I have to make a decision tomorrow. I have to decide on whom I gamble or not.
The biggest gamble may be in central defence. Would Oleg Luzhny emerge as a partner for Martin Keown, with both men struggling for fitness? Dennis Bergkamp was expected to join Thierry Henry up front. Whoever plays, Arsenal's manager believes opponent Southampton are already in their debt.
They're already qualified for Europe. And thanks to us. So they can be thankful on Saturday.
The Arsenal team arrived at the hotel they regularly use now yesterday afternoon. In Patrick Vieira's absence, David Seaman has answered the call to captain the side. It may be his final appearance. So, less than 3 hours to go to kick-off, and Arsenal will shortly be leaving this their lucky hotel. Remember, no side has ever lost a major final after staying here. That luck will have to hold if the Gunners are to salvage something from their season.
So here we are in Cardiff, nice shot there of the Millennium Stadium, and as you can see, the roof is in the process of being closed. A late decision was made this morning that for the first time in its 122-year history, the FA Cup final will be played indoors. Well, this is where we'll be for the next 2.5 hours or so, and I can, looking out the window, I can tell you that the roof's still got a few yards to go. It apparently takes about an hour. Well, I'll be joined by a number of illustrious names from the football world. Our first two guests are Arsenal's double-double winner, Lee Dixon. He's got his medal there. And Mick Shannon, a key member of Southampton's cup-winning side of 76. Happy memories there. First, let me ask you about the roof being closed. Will that make any difference at all, do you think?
I don't think so. I think there's been a fair bit of rain got on it in the last hour, hasn't there?
Yeah, I think they're worried about the pitch. That's why they've done it, because it was only laid a couple of days ago.
Absolutely. It's amazing what they do now, but what a great stadium, isn't it?
I played in America, lucky enough to play for England against Germany in America on an end-of-season tour, and they had a roof over there, and the atmosphere was unbelievable. And I think the thing the players will find is the fact that there's no wind in the stadium now, which does make a difference.
We saw a few happy memories for you there. Lee, your best cup moment?
Well, I've said before, I enjoyed my first medal winning that, but last year's final against Chelsea, although I didn't play, I was on the bench. I spent most of the second half warming up behind the goal just down here. Yeah. The atmosphere and the fact that the pressure's off you a little bit as substitute, as you probably remember, Gary. As a substitute, the pressure's off you a little bit, and I just really had a great final. Although I didn't get on the pitch, the actual
you didn't make any mistakes.
Yeah, I know. That's one of my better games.
Yeah. Mick, no need to ask you what your best memory was.
Well, I've only had one, but obviously, but the final is so important. I think that all the players, they're so tense and so wound up. Nobody wants to lose a final. People remember the winner, they never remember the runners-up, do they? But it's a great occasion and one of the great sports.
Yeah, I got the impression there, looking at the two camp reports, that it seemed to be a much bigger day for Southampton. I mean, which is fairly obvious, I suppose, because it's less likely they'll be in a final. But shades perhaps of 76, where you were big underdogs against Manchester United.
We were 7 or 8 to 1 outsiders. They're 11 to 2 today. Yeah. So I mean, but I think it's on the day. Southampton haven't got the squad that Arsenal's got, and that's that's obvious. But I think providing they can put it together on the day, and he looks if he's going to probably have a bit of a tactical. There might be a few shocks in his team selection from what I can gather. Naomi looks if he's going to be fit, and there could be a few changes. But as long as they play their game and they've got, it doesn't matter from Southampton's point of view. It doesn't matter what the game's like; it's the result that matters. And I think that they look as if they're going to try and keep it tight, make the game into sort of a little bit of a stalemate, and hopefully if they can load the gun for Beattie. Yeah. Who knows? Could be Southampton.
What about Arsenal, Lee? Are they up for it? Is this the big one for them?
It is a big one. I think there's no difference between the fact of losing the Premiership and then playing in this game. If they'd have won the Premiership, this would have been for the double. Yeah. It's now just to win the FA Cup, as we say. But this is a massive trophy to win. And there'll be no heads dropped, I'm telling you, in that dressing room.
Well, we've got a few pictures of them taking a little stroll this morning, and they look quite relaxed. There's a couple of players, well, David Seaman and Martin Keown on the phone. I presume they're not talking to each other, but a bit of speculation about David Seaman. Will this be his last game for Arsenal? No. You're well in the camp, you know what's going on.
I don't think so. I think things have got to change, certainly in the goalkeeping position over the next few years. He's 39 now, so somebody's got to come in and replace him. But I still think he's the best, one of the best in the Premiership. And I think he fancies that coaching job as well, 3 days a week, bit of fishing. He'll love that job next year.
76, mate. I mean, it's a few years ago now. You must still remember that.
Well, obviously, and it's sad with little Bobby Stokes, who we saw score the winner. He's gone now. But it was a great occasion for everyone. We got a reunion in a minute, so I'm going to have to shoot off from here.
Meeting
all those lads again. It'd be a nightmare. I don't know whether they get on. What time we get on?
You want to see the game, won't you?
But it's great for Southampton, and it's what the town needed. They needed to get to a final again because.
We didn't see your customary celebration in that final because you missed that chance with the keeper. But I mean, you led the way with these celebrations, didn't you?
If I'd copyrighted this, the swinging of the arm, I'd have been a rich lad,
There you go. Where did that start?
I don't know. I was usually on my own. I was up the pitch so far on my own. I had a long time to get back to the rest of the lads. We used to play a system 1-9-1 in them days.
Lee was telling me earlier on that you used to do that, didn't you? Not very often.
No,
when you were
once,
a kid.
Once I did it. I used to copy. I was a Man City supporter, so He led the way in Manchester for that celebration.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. I didn't realise you were that young.
Well, I must say, it's nice to have you again as a pundit, Mick, because the last time you were in a pundit, which was about 17 years ago, in a World Cup, you made me famous. You called me the boy line-ater. And I get asked about that. People still call me that
so
to this day.
Wherever
boy,
I go.
They've missed the boy bit out now, don't they?
Yeah, well, gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us. And enjoy your day.
Thank you.
Cheers. Now, the FA Cup, of course, is very much the fans' day. And as ever, there's no shortage of colour outside. Southampton in yellow today, so they lost the toss for team colours, as you can see. But the customary scenes outside, silly hats and...
Come on, you say!
All looking forward to the day ahead. Still a few hours to go, but the streets are pretty packed with... Oh, dear. Some people will do anything to get on the television. In fact, I'll tell you what, it makes one feel like bursting into verse.
It still isn't the most saving trophy in football.
Hey, Eddie, we've scored a goal.
It's there!
There's many a one who'd be idle if the biting hunger for that sweet taste of victory didn't conspire to raise expectation to within an inch of the Artex on the average dreamer's ceiling, where footballs ricochet in the memory along roads we didn't take,